What was garbage in 1860 was fertilizer in 1870, cattle feed in 1880, and table food and many other things else in 1890. Before the 1890s, Western society only consumed animal fat. Tallow, suet, lard, and butter are all examples of these fats. Eastern societies use cold-pressed fats like coconut and palm oil. Vegetable oils like we know them today simply did not exist. The Industrial Revolution brought a rise in machinery, which required oil to run. At first, whale oil was the main fuel for these new machines. But as the whale population dwindled, the need for these oils continued to rise. Society needed another fuel, and that became cottonseed oil. It made sense. Cotton production was increasing by the year, and there was nothing to do with the seeds that came along with the plant. Now the scraps could finally be put to use. However, when fossil fuels were discovered, the need for cottonseed oil to power machines went away. The cotton seeds became useless again. Procter & Gamble, originally a soap-making company, used the newly invented hydrogenation process and once again found a use for the cotton seeds. They originally used coconut and palm oil to make their soaps, but switched to the cheaper cotton seeds when they had the opportunity. Then they realized that the soap resembled lard and figured that they could sell it as a substitute. This is where Crisco was born, the first vegetable oil. They vigorously marketed their product through various campaigns. One of their campaigns focused on the liberation of women who would no longer have to churn butter and the liberation of animals who were no longer necessary for oil. They also got the message into the minds of consumers by claiming that it was the new product on the block. Another marketing strategy they used was free cookbooks, which listed Crisco as the base oil in every recipe. It was the cool new product that was cheaper than butter, but supposedly just as elegant. As it became evident that these once useless seeds could be made into food, other products containing them emerged. One of the most successful was margarine, first made with coconut oil and lard, but then made strictly with seed oils. Procter & Gamble then switched to soybean oil because it was even cheaper than cottonseed oil. Margarine and Crisco were the first vegetable oils to enter the market. As their popularity grew and it became easier to stabilize these oils, other companies started to sell them as cooking oil. Animal fats and the original Eastern vegetable oils contain mostly saturated fat. These so-called vegetable oils, which are actually seed oils, contain mostly polyunsaturated fats. For those wondering about the general manufacturing process of these oils, first, the seeds are gathered. Many of them are GMO, so they will have glyphosate residue on them, a pesticide and known carcinogen. They are then heated to extremely high temperatures, potentially leading to oxidation. This could be very problematic for your health, something we'll cover more in detail in the next video. They are then processed in a solvent like hexane, a chemical made from crude oil. They then deodorize the oil to get rid of the inherent rancid smells. Then, more chemicals are added to give the oil a clearer color. The American Heart Association was launched in 1924, but few Americans had heart disease, so it was pretty irrelevant. Heart disease was actually very rare until the 1920s. Procter & Gamble paid the American Heart Association $1.5 million to promote Crisco as a healthy alternative to animal fats in 1948. It seems like this large investment paid off. Americans started associating saturated fats with heart failure when President Eisenhower had a heart attack and was out of office for 10 days in 1955. It helped gain awareness of the rising rates of cardiovascular disease, which the media associated with saturated fat. Eisenhower was also a heavy smoker, but that fact didn't seem to gather nearly as much attention. Saturated fats continued to be demonized when Ancel, an American physiologist, published his diet-heart hypothesis in 1958. Notice that it is only a hypothesis. He looked at 7 countries and found a positive correlation between fat consumption and heart disease. The problem is that he left out other countries that didn't fit his hypothesis. Cherry-picking data doesn't seem very scientific at all. In 1961, the American Heart Association wrote the first official recommendations to reduce intake of total fat, saturated fat, and cholesterol, and to increase intake of polyunsaturated fat. This advice was then used in the 1977 U.S. Dietary Guidelines. These cheap, industrial, heavily processed oils were marketed as health food, and their consumption continued to rise.
Sure, my family likes fast food chicken, but I like knowing exactly what they're eating. So when I can, I make the chicken they eat. With fast food chicken, you don't know what they fry it in.
At that point, animal fats had been disparaged, and the public perception of saturated fats was very negative. However, palm and coconut oil still had a small share of the market. The American Soy Association had successfully lobbied Congress in the 1930s to put taxes on these Asian-made oils. But they had to start aggressive slander campaigns when these oils were gaining popularity again in the 1980s. The irony is that people in Malaysia and the Philippines consumed massive amounts of palm and coconut oil, and heart disease was pretty much non-existent there. At the same time, Phil Sokolof, an American multimillionaire businessman, campaigned against saturated fats. He had suffered a heart attack and apparently wanted to protect Americans from cardiovascular disease. He led philanthropic efforts to eliminate saturated fats from the American diet. First, he contacted food conglomerates, and when they didn't respond, he put out hit pieces on them. He is credited for single-handedly driving McDonald's to switch from tallow to polyunsaturated fats. He also pushed numerous companies to move from saturated fat to polyunsaturated fat, and for people to drink skim milk. Sokolov later died from heart failure. I wonder how many people suffered the same fate because of his recommendations. The Center for Science in the Public Interest also gave the same advice. Maybe some of these activists, especially Sokolov, actually believed that saturated fats caused heart disease. They really just went off the government's guidelines, which were probably based on profit and not public health. Now, almost every single processed food you see will contain one of these low-quality polyunsaturated oils. Everything from chips to cookies to bread. Look at the labels on the foods in your pantry and you will see what I mean. Also, almost every single restaurant will use these oils to cook. Nina Teicholz explains some of the problems restaurants have with these oils in one of her talks.
He says, ever since they've gone to these trans-free oils, they have been having these horrible cleaning problems. They understand them as cleaning problems because the fryers are getting clogged, because the oils turn into polymers. When they go through all this heated, that long molecule I showed you becomes degraded and broken up, and it changes into other kinds of polymers, and that, like the polymers in paint, right? So they would clog up the drains, and they would have this gooey, sticky stuff on the walls, and they would try to scrape it off, and nobody could scrape it off, so they had to invent a new cleaner that was extra strong, that had sort of extra strength chemicals in it, that to use to try to depolymerize the stuff on the walls and in the drains and on the floors of all these fast food places. He said the polymers, these degraded molecules were so unstable that when they would put the uniforms in the backs of trucks to go take them to the cleaners, the uniforms would spontaneously combust. And then when they took them, they'd clean them, and they put them in the dryers. There were still so many of these toxic chemicals in them that they would explode in the dryers. So, I mean, just imagine, we're just all putting this in our bodies.
Her book, The Big Fat Surprise, is an excellent source of information on this entire topic. Despite the facts, the most recent recommendations state, Individuals should aim to shift food choices from those high in saturated fats to those high in polyunsaturated and monounsaturated fats. By November 2013, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration finally removed partially hydrogenated oils from the list of human foods generally recognized as safe. It's good to know that the American Heart Association has been telling Americans to consume unsafe food for decades. When is this charade going to end? The only way to avoid these garbage oils is to read labels, avoid restaurants that cook in these oils, and stay educated on the foods that you put into your body. Stay away from fats made from seeds or beans. Some safe plant oils would include olive, coconut, and avocado. These plants don't have to be chemically processed to obtain oil from. Your best bet is to cook your own food in saturated fat from one of these plants or an animal fat such as butter. Is it incompetence or malice? Tell us why in the comments below. Please share this video with anyone who still cooks in vegetable oil so they get a better understanding of how it got into their pantry. Then check out our next video, which describes the impact that these seed oils have on your health.